Thanks, Robert. Thanks for having us here in this space. My name is Lana. I'm a grassroots organizer here in Toronto. First of all, I just wanted to acknowledge the land that we're on, the Mississauga, the Haudenosaunee, the Huron, and possibly other nations that have called this place their home. I wanted to thank the sponsors of the event, the Center for Social Justice, Science for Peace, and Socialist Project. And we'll get right into it, because we have lots of great speakers. And just to provide a bit of an introduction, the Canadian intervention in Iraq began slowly with little debate, but is quickly growing. In early September, several dozen military advisors were deployed to northern Iraq. On October 7th, a vote passed in the House of Commons to launch a combat mission. Soon after, on October 16th, the first wave of troops were sent over to the base in Kuwait, followed by another wave on October 23rd. There are now up to 6 CF-18 fighter jets, 2 Aurora surveillance aircraft, and a CC-150 Polaris air-to-air tanker at the Kuwaiti base. The first Canadian attack mission, an actual attack, was carried out on November 2nd, targeting ISIL bulldozers and a dump truck in Fallujah, Iraq. Now Canadian officials are trying to come up with a legal case to go into Syria as well. And though the initial commitment is for 6 months, it's widely expected to expand and turn into another prolonged intervention in the Middle East. And as Tyler will explain, Canada has a history of imperial military interventions and has recently developed a new foreign policy stance that attempts to boost such activity. Canada, of course, was heavily involved in the invasion of Afghanistan, and Judy will provide some background on this as well as the Iraq wars and address the aftermath. As Sabah will explain, one of the consequences of the U.S.-led invasion in Iraq was the creation of ISIL, which is now indeed a threat to people in the region. And a very important and strong front against ISIL is in northern Syria in the autonomous Kurdish region of Rojava. This area also happens to be one of the most inspiring models of direct democracy in the world right now. And Sardar will tell us about that, the Rojava Revolution, and update us on the battle to protect it. And just to tell you a little bit about our speakers, to my right, is Tyler Shipley. Tyler Shipley completed his PhD at York University and currently teaches economics and political science at Humber College.
Thanks, Lena. Thank you all very much for being here. I'll see if I can get this thing close enough. I've already talked for 3 hours today, so my vocal cords are warmed up. If I have to just shout, I can do that. I certainly have some practice. So I will, I think, try to very briefly give a kind of an overview, sort of a backgrounder to what I think is going to come next, which I think in many ways is the part I'm most interested in. So I'm going to sort of try to just kind of front load a bit of background here on Canadian imperialism, on the development of a Canadian imperial foreign policy, how that has come about, how that manifests itself today, and what that's doing to Canadian culture as well. Most of us are probably more or less embedded in the sort of Canadian culture around us and have probably noticed the extent to which it's become very aggressively militarized, really, over the past decade. It's ubiquitous, the kind of military stuff that is being pumped through the Canadian cultural apparatus. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about that, if I have time at the end, and the way that that fits into reshaping Canadian foreign policy. I suppose the best place to start is to very, very briefly, and I can't possibly do this justice in the time I have, but just acknowledge the, I suppose, absurdity of Stephen Harper's statement that Canada has no colonial history. I'm sure that came as absurd to you as it did to me when he said that. And of course, it speaks to a sort of a comical way in which the Harper government currently justifies its colonial policies abroad by claiming that it has no colonial history, which is, of course, incorrect in just about every possible way. Clearly, the project that created Canada was a colonial project. The direct theft of indigenous territory, often by violent force. Dispossession of indigenous territory through the use of deeply problematic treaty process, which all of you probably know quite well. The destruction of indigenous culture, and of course by culture I don't mean the sort of tokenistic things that Canada celebrates at the Vancouver Olympics. I mean culture in the very real sense, as a way of life, a way of organizing society, politically, economically, socially. The ways that indigenous people lived were actively undermined and we could say destroyed, if not for the fact that indigenous people have continued to resist. Certainly the goal of the Canadian state was to destroy indigenous culture, which is a hallmark of colonialism. Obvious signposts for this claim would include the banning of the potlatch, right, an indigenous economic and social and cultural ceremony practice in which economic wealth was redistributed between communities. This obviously is a direct contradiction with the capitalist colonial project that Canada had. So one of the first laws passed by the new Canadian government when it became a Canadian government was to ban the potlatch. Residential schools, of course, is another obvious example of the attempt by the Canadian state to truly destroy indigenous culture in a very colonial project. There are many others. Obviously, the Indian Act, which was a very clear legal structure of apartheid, one that was emulated in other apartheid systems, most notably, I think, Adolf Hitler, who was a great admirer of Canadian policy towards indigenous people. We could go on and on about this, but I trust that a lot of us in this room know this history quite well. And I will close on this point simply by noting that this colonial project is ongoing. This is not a colonial project of the past. It is one of the present, and the struggles over oil and gas, mining, other industries that are trying to encroach on what's left of indigenous territory is an obvious sort of marker of that ongoing colonial conflict. Okay, my second point, the second place that I want to go here is to ask the question, is Canada independent? And I ask that because in order to make the claim that Canada is an imperialist power, which is a claim that I will make, we have to agree in the first instance that Canada has independence, that Canada has the capacity to be its own independent colonial power. I don't think this should be controversial, but it is, because broad sections of certainly the Canadian mainstream and indeed parts of the Canadian left have for a very long time been invested in the idea that Canada is a dependency of the United States, that the US is the imperial power, and we're just sort of being pulled along behind. That to a certain extent we don't even have agency. The Canadian state is not an agent of imperialism, it's a victim of it. I think that particular piece of the argument is a real stretch, but certainly I think there are reasons, legitimate reasons, why people have argued that Canada holds the bully's coat. This is the line that Linda McQuaig in particular has used to describe Canada's foreign policy. We sort of just hold the coat for the bully while the bully goes out and bullies. A couple of points I want to make about this. I think the first is just to say that if this is the case, we should at least acknowledge first that this has been going, we've been holding the coat for a really, really long time. We've been holding the coat as far back as 1918 when Canada invaded Russia to try to defeat the workers' revolution that had pulled Russia out of the First World War. We sent troops to Siberia. A lot of people don't know that. China in the 1930s and 40s, Canada was a strong supporter of the Japanese fascist occupation of China. Politically and diplomatically, Canada made statements in support of the Japanese fascist project in Manchuria, and then in 1937 in the attack on Nanjing. And indeed, Canada sent gunboats to the waters off of China in support of Chiang Kai-shek and the nationalists after the war, during the Civil War in China, with the United States, of course. Chile in the 1970s, again, one obvious signpost example, when Chileans democratically elected Salvador Allende, a socialist, in 1970, Canada, under the Trudeau government, immediately cut off all aid and began treating Chile as a pariah state. That policy stance was maintained throughout Allende's government, But in 1973, when Allende was assassinated and overthrown in a plot orchestrated by the CIA, Canada immediately, almost immediately, within weeks of Pinochet's rise to power, Canada recognized the Pinochet government and restarted its aid program. In fact, ending up spending hundreds of millions of dollars in aid and loans to Chile, to Pinochet, in part to fund his apparatus of repression. So, Canada has been holding the bullies code for a long time. This isn't new. What I think is new, what I think needs to be added to the story, is that Canada has always had a fair bit of independence in this process. Canada hasn't been simply towing the line that the US has told it to tow. In fact, Canada has often been the, I guess, the prime mover of relations, foreign relations between Canada and the United States. To give you an example, NATO, the NATO alliance, which according to the left nationalist thesis would look like a case where Canada was roped into following the US line. Well, actually, Canada pushed NATO. Canada was, the idea came from Canada, it was pushed by Canada, and it was the US that actually acquiesced to the creation of NATO. That's one example, there are several. I feel like I'm probably spending too much time on this point, so I'll move on. But I do want to close this point by saying that today, in particular, it's very clear that Canada has policy independence. Canada has a concentrated capitalist class within Canada. A couple of figures that would be of note here. The 250 largest Canadian corporations have on their boards of directors less than 500 individuals, people who sit on multiple boards of multiple corporations. That is an incredible level of concentration in the Canadian capitalist class. It's actually more concentrated than the American capitalist class, which means that the Canadian capitalist class it has some coherence. It is able to put forward a coherent position and a particular kind of pressure on the Canadian state. I'm making this point simply to respond to those who would say Canada has no independence because it's owned by Americans, because assets in Canada are all owned by American firms. And this simply isn't the case. In fact, Canada owns more assets outside of Canada. Canadian companies own more assets outside of Canada than other foreign companies own assets within Canada. To sort of further this point, Canada is now the ninth highest source of foreign direct investment in the world. We are exporting capital, not importing it. So I hope I haven't skated over this too quickly, but the point I'm trying to make here is that the Canadian capitalist class is consolidated. It is Canadian, it is uniquely Canadian, and it applies a particular pressure on the Canadian state to pursue Canadian interests, not simply to follow whatever the line is from Washington. With that in mind, I want to talk now a little bit about the contemporary Canadian imperial project and what it looks like and how it is manifest and where it is manifest, and obviously some of this will come up from the other speakers, in particular with Afghanistan and Iraq. I don't want to exaggerate the legacy of peacekeeping, the mythology of peacekeeping, because it is an exaggeration. The extent to which Canada has been a peacekeeping nation, the extent to which that has been Canada's foreign policy is exaggerated in a variety of ways. I do think it's important to distinguish between that moment and this moment. This moment being one where peacekeeping has been really knocked off the agenda entirely, if it ever was. And again, I think, you know, I would probably, if I had more time, I would probably want to argue that it's a bit exaggerated. But needless to say, in this moment, it's very clear that peacekeeping is off the agenda. Even when Canada was involved in peacekeeping, I want to just make one point about that, which is that there was always, at the heart of even the peacekeeping project, there was always a kind of colonial logic at work. And I would point to the Somalia affair in particular as an example of this in 1993, when Canadian soldiers, over 80 members of the Canadian forces were involved and implicated in the torture and abuse and murder of the Somalis, some of the Somalis that they were ostensibly there to protect. I think the language of protect is problematic, but that's kind of the point in a way. There was always a kind of logic that Canadians were better. Canadians were more civilized. They were there to help these poor backwards people. And so, in a sense, it shouldn't be surprising that under particular circumstances, that led to this kind of absurd level of violence that these Canadian soldiers could possibly have thought it would be okay to behave in the way they did, has to speak to the fact that the people they were supposedly protecting have been to a certain extent dehumanized in their mind. This is essential to the logic of colonialism. It was essential in the construction of Canada in the first place in that colonial project, just as it is essential in Afghanistan, in Iraq, it was in Somalia, and so on. Yeah, there's a few other things I want to say about that, but I'm conscious that I'm probably... Three minutes. This is always how it goes, right? Okay, in 3 minutes, let me just put a few places on the map for you as key markers of where Canada has become an aggressive, direct, military imperialist power in the contemporary world. Clearly Afghanistan, the invasion of Afghanistan in 2001, obvious example. The overthrow of a democratically elected government in Haiti in 2004, following 10 years of military interventions, and then followed by an ongoing military presence in Haiti. I would argue Honduras and the support for the military coup in 2009 was a very direct manifestation of Canadian imperialism. Certainly Libya in 2011, Mali in 2013, and of course now Iraq in 2014. There are many things to say about this. I'll make this one point. In explaining why Canada is an imperialist power today, I think there are two things, maybe three, that are really at the center of this that I want to maybe get out before my time runs out. The first is that clearly there is direct material interest that Canada has in imperialism. Mm-hmm. Canadian troops are in Haiti in part to support Gildan, a garment manufacturing company that takes advantage of very cheap labor in Haiti, and the government of Jean-Bertrand Aristide was in the process of enacting limited social reforms that would have affected the profits of Canadian corporations. That pattern repeats itself in almost every single one of these cases. The other pattern that you see is U.S. or Canadian participation in U.S. imperialism. And that is not a contradiction from what I said earlier about Canada having policy independence. I would argue Canada does have policy independence, and it uses that independence to make the decision to join U.S. empire, to align itself with the projects of U.S. imperialism, and thus position Canadian capital to benefit from projects of U.S. empire. Afghanistan, Iraq are perfect examples. Canada's participation, its support for those projects has meant that Canadian corporations have been receiving contracts in the sort of neoliberal dismantling of those places. Afghanistan, you could point to the example of, what's that company? It's a gold mining company, Kilo something, I forget the name of it. Kilo Gold Mines, a Canadian corporation that was awarded a huge contract in Afghanistan after Karzai government was set up. So those are the two, I think, major manifestations or the major reasons, the motivations for the new Canadian imperialism, which obviously I could explain in more detail maybe later or at another time. I probably have about a minute or so. With that last minute, I would like to just close on the idea of Canada as a warrior nation. The idea that Canada is being rebranded, that it is being repackaged and resold to us, those of us who live in Canada, as a state that we should identify as a warrior state. Not a peacekeeping state, but a warrior state. A state that has a strong, powerful, aggressive military that we should be proud of, that we should consider our heroes. The Highway of Heroes, of course, is a primary example of this. I'm a hockey fan, and so I'm constantly inundated with Don Cherry, whose segments, which used to be really bad analysis of hockey, aren't even that anymore. It's just really bad analysis of geopolitics. We're with a lot of sort of incoherent hammering of the desk that always comes back to how great the Canadian military is. The Canadian military is constantly being featured at actual hockey games. They rappel down from the rafters to show us how cool the military is. It's just super, super neat. They play heavy metal music and these guys come down, and sometimes women, to show that we're a very enlightened colonial military because we have women in it. Deeply, deeply problematic, this sort of campaign to rebrand Canada. And it is ubiquitous. I've given a few examples, but I think another one that we are going to notice in particular over the next few years, we've got a little bit of it, a little sneak preview this month, is the commemoration of World War I. And the establishment of Vimy Ridge as this moment, this birth of the nation, You know, when in reality it was an insignificant battle in a stupid colonial war where working people were sent to die on behalf of empires they had no connection to. And in the immediate aftermath of the First World War, Canadian soldiers came back as anti-war activists. They came back as pacifists. They painted, you know, one of the members of the Group of Seven painted incredible pictures of the brutality and stupidity of the war that the Canadian state is now selling back to us as this heroic moment in which Canada was born, in which the true heroes were the warriors, not the peacekeepers, and certainly not the activists, certainly not the trade unionists, or anyone else who resisted projects of Canadian colonialism. So I will leave it there. Thank you very much, and of course we'll...